Let's say you knew all the facts about history, all the facts about what's taking place in the world now, all the hidden secrets, everything about the extraterrestrial presence, you name it, all the hidden secrets. What would that get you? That and a few dollars might get you a pizza or something, but what would it really get you? Where would it get you? To what real benefit is it? However, if you knew that definition and perception are linked with the mind and spirit, if you knew this, what would that get you? That could get you something you really wanted. That could really get you something you wanted. So, we continue on this, what seems to be a track not leading to all these juicy secrets about what's taking place in the world. But it's really the juiciest secret of all. And that is, perception is neutral. It is mind that is interpreting what is being seen. And mind is interpreting what is being seen as an obedient servant of spirit, which told mind, in essence, to do so, to interpret a certain way. Spirit wants to die to what it is because it sees this as the only way it can become something different than what it is, which is to become prime creator. Spirit's desire to be prime creator means that spirit wants to be something other than what it is, different. Since God, everything God created cannot be changed, spirit says, well, I can't change what I am, therefore let me die to what I am. It told the mind, I want to be prime creator, so do this for me. And so mind says, well, you'll have to die to what you are. You'll have to die. And spirit says, well, what's that? Death, what's that? What do you mean die to what I am? Mind says, don't worry, I'll show you. I'll train you. I'll teach you how to die to what you are. Of course, this is all just made up, false hope. Spirit cannot die to what it is. That would be a change also. But spirit tries to say that, no, this is something different. Dying would be something different. So, spirit trying to change what it is, mind is now telling spirit that spirit can be defined. There's some definition of what spirit is, a definition of isness. A definition means something that is not something else, something that has a boundary to it. So, a situation that is not something else, where a spirit is all in all. Okay, so the idea of all in all, having there's something else which is not all in all, which we can define as something real, is not possible. It's not possible. But mind tells spirit, you can die by defining yourself. So what does mind do? Mind has a staging, presents the staging of like a world, like this earth, and presents perception of this world, of this earth, and it tells spirit that perception is seeing all these definitions. Everything is defined. There's all these definitions. And spirit says, wow, really? How's that possible? But mind is lying. Perception is not defining anything. It's mind that is superimposing all these definitions upon perception. Just like in a mirror. A mirror is not defining what is being seen. A mirror is neutral. It's what stands in front of the mirror that is being seen, and the one who is looking, doing the defining. So, let's say there was a human body in front of a mirror, and then all these millions of other people would look in the mirror, at the side of the mirror, and see that human body being reflected in the mirror. Every single one would have a different definition. They'd see it differently. They wouldn't all see it the same at all. But they'd be defining. They say, okay, this is my definition of what I'm seeing. This is a definition of what's being seen. The mirror is not defining what is being seen. Perception is not defining what is being seen. It is mind that is defining what is being seen. And it's defining to try and convince spirit that definition is possible. which is exercise in futility, because spirit cannot change what it is. So spirit can say, well, I see how definition is taking place, but I'm still not dying. And mind says, well, just keep on working at it and you will. But it will not happen. So spirit, mind wants to present stricter definitions, more rigorous definitions. It wants to impose these rigorous definitions on the world. This is the fourth dimensional agenda. We are going through a time now of unparalleled change in definition, where we are changing the intensity of definition into, we are now simply being turned into data, where bodies are defined by all this data that is being collected on them. And this is for the purpose of trying to ratchet up the intensity of definition, of saying to spirit, look, you are nothing but a definition. So us, the human body, human personas in the world, are now really being turned into simply a placeholder that all this data refers to. But the data is the definition. Okay, the data is the definition. So the fourth dimensional is all about data being the definition of what spirit is and what is. And that is why they're collecting, they're doing all this data mining around the world, is because that is the plan of mind. Mind is doing this to try and convince spirit that it can die, that it can die to what it is. So if we know this, what does that get us? What does that get us? Well, what it gets us is the clarity to give mind new marching orders, is to tell mind, hey, I don't want to be prime creator. Therefore, I don't need to your efforts to define what I am. I don't need to engage in that. Therefore, I don't need you to interpret perception as all these things, all these definitions. Therefore, you can show perception as a seamless whole, which will remind me of what I am, what I truly am. That is what it can get you. It can get you enlightenment. What it can get you is enlightenment, which is this vision of oneness, where the mind says, gee, I only see the one. There's only the one. Wonderful. That is what it gets us. So this track that we're going here, that seems to be going off of obsessing about worldly secrets, etc., what it gets us is enlightenment. That's what it gets us. So we better think twice about just overlooking it. The mind will say, there's nothing there. No definitions there. It's going away from definition. It's not important. Going away from definition. Of course it's important. That's what it's all about. That's what the spiritual path is really all about, is to go away from trying to define oneself. Now, the third dimension, of course, defines people loosely with various affiliations. However, the fourth dimension defines people very precisely and with extreme amount of precision and rigor. They will collect every massive amounts of data on every last little thing and then say, look, this data, that is you. This defines what you are. That is the whole program of the fourth dimension. That's why we have these high technology and all these internet companies and everybody collecting this data, is for the purpose of defining who you are. It's an exercise in definition. It's an exercise in definition. And the fact that most of the world is okay with it, say, well, you know, we need security, so that's just a cover story. All this talk about security is just a cover story that mind is presenting. It's some kind of, you know, silly excuse for this. The real purpose is to convince spirit that spirit can be defined and is being defined. And that's why we're going to try, fourth dimension tries to impose this incredible definitional prison on what is. Of course, it's all completely hypothetical and is simply a training exercise that mind is, it's a simulation. It has no reality to it whatsoever. So it doesn't get us anywhere. Spirit still cannot be changed at all. Spirit cannot die to what it is. And so it's all much ado about nothing. truly much ado about nothing. However, participating in this, having attention onto this, does give a feeling, a horrible, horrible feeling of losing oneself, as it were. Feeling what this sense of lack of identity and a need to find identity through controlling others, through defining them more severely. So it's a vicious circle at play in the world right now. It is a vicious circle. The more one lacks a sense of identity, which is beyond definition, that is identity. Identity cannot be defined. It's an acceptance of oneself as one is, as spirit, as the all residing in the all, as it were. The more we lack identity by defining ourselves through thingness, or trying to define ourselves through thingness, the more we feel like we need to get an identity, a sense of identity, by defining others. And the more we go along then towards trying to collect data on everybody else and pigeonhole everybody else, thinking that that will give us a sense, a greater sense of identity. So it's a negative, terrible downward spiral into darkness. And the sense of lack of identity gets worse and worse and worse. And then people more and more band together in groups, trying to impose their will and control and their definition onto others. Of all in the name of freedom, of course, and in the name of all these, it's all very positive, wonderful rainbows, etc. And birds and singing and everything's wonderful, But that is not what's really taking place. So there are safeguards against this sort of thing. When society has realized, wait a minute, let's not try to reduce ourselves to definitions. Let us turn towards that which reminds us of the seamlessness of reality, the undefined seamlessness of reality. And those safeguards are being torn down now by the fourth dimensionals. That is their agenda. Their agenda is to tear down the safeguards and to impose this extreme definitional push on everyone, where the data defines you. The data defines you. Which is completely opposite to reality, where there is nothing in particular that can ever define what you are. You are beyond definition. Reality is truly beyond definition. So the path to enlightenment is all important right now. It's all important. And we now realize that this data situation that has been going on for quite some time is not going to abate at all, really. And in fact, it's going to become ever more prevalent in many, many different ways. It's invaded our culture and society like a cancer, and now it's completely metastasized throughout society, where you more still have, you will have a identity card, you will have all this stuff is coming, where that will continue to collect data, more and more data, more and more data, and then you will all be, profiled according to the data. And it just goes on and on and on and on and on. It's truly a road to perdition that leads to greater and greater conflicts, because there's a feeling that you're losing your identity, and then you blame that on someone else, that they need to be controlled more. They have too much freedom. They're not willing to accept your definition of them, you see, and then that leads to problems. Big problems. So, fortunately, the answer is right in plain sight, literally, in that we can at least take a glimpse, at least in some way, accept that our perception is something that we are making up. For instance, if you look at a mountain in the distance, you say, oh, I see a mountain. I see this mountain. There's a mountain. I see a mountain. Is it a mountain? Is it really a mountain? Who said it's a mountain? Is there a mountain there? Is there actually a mountain? There's some boundary that this is a mountain. It's very compelling. The case is very compelling, isn't it? That we think we see things. So there needs to be some sort of boost that we get where we experience no thingness and we realize it's there. But this needs to be done in a certain context, a rich context, where we understand what's going on. Otherwise, it might just throw us into just a incredible confusion. Say, wait a minute, what's going on? How do I get back here? How do I get there? How does this add up? But the big boost would certainly be to experience no thingness, experience of no thingness, and to then see the connection between mind, perception, spirit, spirit's desire to be prime creator directly is the cause of mind claiming that there are all these things, discrete things. Is the mountain a discrete thing? Is a lake a discrete thing? An actual discrete thing? Is a tree, are there any actual discrete things? Is that actually true? We can believe it's true. We can believe it true. It's true. But is there an actual real tree, so to speak? Is there a real tree there? Or are we claiming that this is a tree? There's a claim being made that there are all these discrete, separate things. It's a big question. It's an all-important question. Because what we are trying to do is say that spirit is a discrete thing. A separate, discrete thing or something. And therefore separate from reality. In other words, with the spirit dying to what it really is. Which is not a discrete thing separate from the allness, the wholeness of reality. So this may seem very abstract, but it's actually the most practical examination of all. How to examine it directly is the question. Let us say we're working towards this, So at least the tension is there. We start to, you know, take a look and say, hey, what can be done with this? What can be done? It's something that has to be done. It's something that has to be done. Without seeing the vision of oneness, spirit continues to be damned, as it were, which is to keep believing that it's a thing, or it can become a thing, or it can die to what it is. Salvation is really the realization by spirit that it cannot die to what it is. It cannot become a thing. It's released from this false belief. Enlightenment is like a release from a false hope, a false belief. And it's a great relief to spirit and say, oh my gosh, I can never become a thing. There are no things. There's only one. There's only God. So this is the great relief of enlightenment. And fortunately, we have this right in front of us. That we will certainly get a boost in this direction. Those who want this boost and praying for it and intending it to happen, it will certainly happen for them. Now, even though you may say, well, I don't quite understand this, well, that's fine. Well, welcome to the club. We're all pretty much in that club. There's very few that have truly come face to face and absorb this entirely and truly living this realization. But there are quite a few who are in the ballpark with it. Quite a few. That's enough. It's enough to be in the ballpark. You don't have to be in the front row. Now, this is very important. Like you go to a baseball game, you get your ticket, you go inside, you walk up the stairs, you know, the concourse, you're walking around, you go through the opening into the seats, and you walk through the tunnel out into the seats, and suddenly you're saying, oh, I don't care where my seat is. This is really cool. This is really, really cool to see this. Ah, I'm so happy to, I'm at the ballpark. It's like that. It doesn't matter if you're what aisle or row or your seat is or whatever, as long as you're in the ballpark, you're good to go. So as long as you say, you know what, I have a willingness to at least look at this in this direction, that's good enough. That is good enough. Because success will start to come. Success will start to come. As we realize the tawdry aspects of the fourth dimensional stuff. Just how crass it really is. And how unexamined it really is. How foolish, how eccentric, how whimsical, and what a waste of our attention it is. Cheap, gaudy trinkets, all this fourth dimensional stuff. So we realize that, then we say, hey, yeah, what are our options? And then we say, oh, our options are that we can, enlightenment is our option. This vast relief that we are not a thing, we've never been a thing, and we never can be a thing. We cannot be defined. And all is still one, and all is still perfect, etc. And this oneness. Oneness is still one. And we can realize that. We can see it. We can experience it. Come face to face with it. So this is the relief that we have waiting for us. It's a vast relief. So we are not in a bad position at all. The world is in a very bad position. It's interesting. People have certain... You can tell how you react to the situation. For instance, I don't like filling out forms. I hate forms. I don't like putting my name, writing my name, you know, any sort of forms. Go to a doctor's office. I always joke. I say, I can't get sick because I can never fill out the forms in a doctor's office. I have some kind of a severe aversion to any data, putting down any data, any definition of what I am. I have a severe aversion to that. Can't stand it. I'd rather almost die than, you know, fill out a form. It's just like yanking teeth for me. And so this kind of shows how I feel that I cannot be defined. I resist any attempt to define what I am. That's why I feel so uncomfortable in this world, like a fish out of water. So uncomfortable is because there's constant ongoing building attempts to define what we are in so many different directions. This is what you are. You are this. This is the data. This is what you do. This is this. And they're asking for more and more information about you constantly to try and get you defined by a machine. Less and less human interaction. Where you interact with humans, they say, you get this feeling more of like, hey, you know, we're not really these bodies and these roles and any of this. And there's that feeling like that's the sort of a love and compassion of like, I know this is all just a simulation. But when you deal with some nameless, faceless, you know, automated voice, all computerized, etc., you don't get that sense. You get the sense that you're being viewed as just data. And I very much detest that entire thing. I'd like to just let it all go into the ocean, absolutely. Or, even better yet, let myself go into the ocean. Ocean of oneness. Let all that stuff stay on shore. I'm going into the ocean. That's the feeling. Where one is not lost because one is not searching for a definition. We get lost when we search for a definition of what we are. That is the lostness. The feeling that we're lost is because we are looking for a definition of what we are. Giving up the search means we know what we are now. Because it's inherent, what we are is we already are what we are. Why do we need to find what we are? We don't. We don't need to be found. Seeking is always seeking for a definition of what we are. And then as soon as we seek for a definition of what we are, we're lost. If we have this beautiful epiphany, and then we start seeking for a definition of it, label, how do I label this? Poof, it's gone. We feel lost to it. It's still there, but we're not there anymore. Our attention is no longer there. Our attention is to search for a label, how do I label this? How do I label this? How do I define this epiphany? So we could have this incredible epiphany, incredibly beautiful epiphany, and as soon as we say, our mind says, oh boy, how am I going to define this for everybody else? Poof, it's gone, it's gone. And we think, oh, it's abandoned me, God has abandoned me. No, we've abandoned reality. We've tried to abandon God by searching for a label for this, a definition of it. Your real friends are those who allow you to simply be without trying to define what you are, without having to label experiences, label situations, and say this is what this is, so to speak. There's a sense of spaciousness and freedom there, which we don't get from machines. All the gadgets of fourth dimensional culture, I mean, all these people interacting with these voices on their dumb phones, extremely bad training for people. Simulating the idea that there's a human there is talking to you. No, it's just a computer program. It's a machine language program that is defining you from the previous questions and answers, building up a database on you and saying, this is what is there. You know, it's a very bad training. You see the kids, younger generation who've now simply grown up with the dumb phones, and they can't get out of the dumb phones because for them, the dumb phone is defining what they are. So they see the dumb phone as their God, actually. They really do. And they will walk in traffic like this, and you have to look out for them because they see without the dumb phone, they'll lose their identity. Because the dumb phone is defining for them, constantly defining for them what they are. So you have an entire generation in the world now locked in to this mania, this dumbness of feeling that technology defines what they are. It's really a techno-totalitarian society that is already here, because the younger generation, of course, they're the ones who get power, make rules, make the laws, and make the decisions as they grow up, as the older people get pushed down onto the ash heap of history. And they will see that they have to be defined by machines and robots and computers. Without robots and computers and machines, etc., defining them, they feel that they have no identity or existence whatsoever. And so, you know, there's nothing that the old folks can do about it other than, you know, confiscate all the dumb phones and throw them in the ash heap of history, which would be a very smart move to make, actually. Other than that, the inexorable push towards this is just a terrible steamroller. It's all been obvious. I've seen it happening from day one. I mean, it's just something that's completely out in the open, completely obvious, and completely discernible. And yet everybody thinks that this is the inevitable, you know, this is inevitable that happens. No, it wasn't inevitable at all. It was not. It's just that people were marketed and intrigued by it and all, and it's, you know, they don't realize the danger of it. They don't realize the danger of it. More and more, we are interacting with computer voices, voice simulation. Very bad. All this stuff is very, very bad, actually. It should have been stopped. That if you want to suppress something, that should have been suppressed. Absolutely. All this stuff. all this high technology should have been suppressed in because it leads downward. It leads downward. It leads into darkness, very bad darkness, where severe spiritual darkness. Of course, it markets itself as liberating us all from some sort of darkness. It's pretty funny how it turns things upside down like that, backwards. Because what it says is it's fulfilling. It's fulfilling the drive to define what we are. It's a fulfillment. So, and it claims ultimate success. But of course, wisdom tells us that there is no success. So, when you believe that the impossible can be accomplished, you will think that the means you're using is all going to end well. But it doesn't. It just spirals down into greater and greater and greater darkness, and then you reach some point where you just say, oh my gosh, this is just so horrific, so terrible. I see no way out. That's what happens. One feels like, no way I can ever find my identity. I'm so completely defined by all these, this universe, these things, all these technology, etc. I'm so utterly defined by this all. How can I possibly get free of it, you know? And it's a terrible, terrible situation. Now, of course, eventually one can, but one has to... The long trek out of darkness is not a joke. And so you might say this planet has been contaminated. The contamination is all this technology, is the contamination. This that leads to simulated voices, simulated people, robotic interaction, data mining, all the collection of data, etc., etc., etc. All that is leading into darkness, where you feel more and more defined by thingness. Okay, greater and greater, more severe definition of what we are. Whereas truly, what we are is beyond any and all definition, forever. And so, the trend is in the wrong direction. Technology is a wrong directional trend. The high technology that we have. Technology can take some of the burdens of existence off of us if we use it wisely. We haven't used it wisely. If we put the right restraints on it, we haven't put the right restraints on it. It's too late to put the right restraints on it. Way too late. That should have been done, you know, 30 years ago. But greed blinds people. A lot of things blind people. The marketing, all it was a combination of factors, very artfully done by mine. And even the people saw, hey, this isn't good. Nobody listened to them, really. They said, well, let me check this out. This is interesting. Maybe this can make my life a little more comfortable. Not realizing the dark side of it. So it presented this smiley face, but really, It's the dark side. It's going over to the dark side is what has happened. You might say that technology, high tech, is the dark side. Going over that is the dark side. There can be some wise uses of it within limits, but that is not what is happening. So what happens as we spiral down in the darkness? Well, we certainly don't even need to go down that rabbit hole, because what happens is eventually you bottom out is what happens. And then you have to, the long trek out of it is what happens. That's what happens. There's no reason to define and label blow by blow, like the fight, it was a fight going on. We don't need to narrate the fight and talk about the blows being landed, etc. We say, there's a fight, they're beating each other up, and eventually the fight will be over, and then they'll have to recover from it, and that's it. There's no reason to label and specify. And then, again, that's just a defining of what's taking place. We don't need data on what is impossible. We don't need to data mine the attempt to accomplish the impossible. There's no reason to, because the answer is it's futile. Why do we need data about futility? It won't help, it won't change the futility of it. We can never be defined. So why do we need to a history of the attempts towards definition? We don't. So we're not missing anything. And say we had never come to this world, we didn't miss anything at all. We didn't miss anything at all. This whole simulation of time, preparing us for, as it were, a new creation of time, step into time, which will never happen. Nothing's happening here. Futility, in futility, nothing really happens. Something that is just failure for anything to happen is what's going on. But why, you know, delineate and label all this? It's just a blanket, really, it's just a blanket judgment of everything. Just a blanket label of all of this. It's just nothing, nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. That is true. In this world, there's truly nothing to see in this world from that standpoint. And how you can, however, see oneness, which is no longer a world. It's no longer a world. It's no longer things. It is simply a stupendous bliss. So we can give that purpose to what previously had no purpose to it. It was just simply futility. So in looking at all this, we actually realize we do have an option. Even though I know people are saying, well, yeah, that's very tough. I don't know how to, I can't quite get this. Again, join the club. Because why do we struggle? Because we try to label. We say, okay, how do I label this? I'm not quite sure how to label what's being said. That is the whole problem. The problem is to go beyond labeling. I've had many epiphanies, but they always seem to slip through my fingers. Why? What are fingers? Labels. We're trying to label. Okay, this is how I label this, and the epiphany slips right through those labels. And you look at your hand, and you don't have anything in your hand really. You got nothing but empty, stale labels. You don't have the epiphany because you're looking at your hand, trying to grasp it. Trying to grasp something in your hand is trying to define it. So when the master holds the pebble, do I have a pebble? No. Well, I have flower petals, and I say, the master says, "Okay, you snatch this flower petals from my hand, and you will now be the master." And the answer, of course, is I don't need to snatch anything from your hand. Meaning, I don't need to grasp it through labels, okay? The hand and the fingers are labels. And the master is holding this open hand, like, say, here, you know. And every time you try to grasp it, you know, you can't get it. Can't get it. You keep missing it. Finally, you realize, you tell the master, "Master, I don't need to grasp anything out of your hand." Then the master says, now you get it. Now you get it. And that's where we're at. We're at the situation. We're at the place right now where we can say to the master, "Hey, I don't need to label anything. I don't need to label epiphanies. I don't need to define them. I don't need to grasp them through labels. I can just enjoy them, just experience them, and I can tell others to do the same." Of course, fourth dimensionals have a very tough time even entertaining this in the slightest degree. Well, reformed fourth dimensionals certainly can, who are realizing, hey, this being trying to define what I am is horrible. And so that they're repenting. They say, "I want to reform. I want out of that situation. I want to repent." They can certainly get it. But those who are gung-ho on fourth dimension, they want to stamp that out. They don't want that anywhere near them. They say, "Oh, it's just mumbo jumbo crazy stuff." They lump it all into quote unquote religion or something. You know, it's the enemy. Because religion says, "Hey, go easy on your definition, you know. Let's not try and do that. Ease up on it, partner." But most religions don't go nearly far enough. They basically are saying, "Hey, ease up, come on, let's not go that route, which is fine. But then you have to go all in and accept that freedom from labels and definitions. to complete that path, as it were. Accept it. Accept it. And we are just trying to decide which road to go down. You don't want to just sit there and pout about it. That's the wrong way. Yeah, I understand that many are at that point now. Well, the way you can describe the world right now is there's a whole lot of people pouting. There really are a whole lot of people pouting. They're very upset. They're very angry because now they see there's two roads. And they're not ready to choose. And so they're angry. So they have a sit down. They sit down and says, we're not going anywhere. We're not going anywhere. And the fourth dimension will say, oh, yes, you are. Whether you like it or not, you're going down our road. And they say, no, we don't wanna move. Well, history has a way of moving you along, doesn't it? So what's important is to get over our pouting. This is what the Big Boost is designed for. Because we all, deep down, are a little bit pouty right now, actually. We're kind of upset at the fourth dimensional, what they're doing to this planet, and being forced to choose, because we kind of feel like, I'm not quite ready to choose. I still want some I want to be defined in some way, maybe just really nice, glowing terms or something, but this feeling of non-definition, I don't know, you know, I'm not really quite prepared. So we do have some resistance and antagonism toward the whole situation, and we're kind of prickly and, you know, snappy, a little bit snappy. So the Big Boost is designed to help us shed that poutiness. I still have some, absolutely. There's some resentment, you know. I just say, wow, I don't like being pushed so severely, which the fourth dimensionals have been pushing everybody so severely, relentlessly. It's like, wow, it'd be nice to just, you know, have enjoyed life, enjoyed, you know, my experience in this world a little bit, but no, never. There's been constant push. It's like a tsunami approaching, you know, you're not happy about it, because you say, I just can't just sit here on the beach. I've got to, you know, run as fast as possible up that that hill there, get to higher ground, and you're just sweating, and you think, oh gosh, I can't enjoy the day on the beach. That's terrible. But that's what we have. So the Big Boost shows us that being formless, having no definition, having no label what we are, abiding in that is wonderful. It's wonderful. There's no reason to pout, and that we can do it. The main thing about pouting is think, we're going to mess it up. No, we can do it. We can do it. We don't have to go down the fourth dimensional route. We do not have to. So one way or another, we have to come out of our poutiness, one way or the other. I would just say the Big Boost helps us with that, without trying to be too definitive about labeling how it's accomplished. It helps us with that. We say, hey, it's no big deal. It's okay. Let the fourth dimensionals do their thing, and we'll do our thing. Gets us past the poutiness. We need to get past the poutiness. Because that's the hang-up right now. That's really the hang-up. People resent being pushed. They do. For the most part. So hopefully we will get a lot of help with that coming up. And we'll take to it like a duck takes to water. We'll say, okay, that's okay. I know I'm, you know, we want to keep some resentment towards the fourth dimension being pushed so much. We want to, you know, you want to hold on to some of that, but that prevents us from going to where we want to go. So we really just have to let go of that resentment, one way or the other. And we can do that. We can do that. It can build back, but we really need to flush it out of our system, this resentment, and even say thank you to them for pushing us so severely. Otherwise, we would have probably just become very indolent in third dimensional life and just, you know, not really pushed ourselves. So at some point we will get over the resentment of how things are going in this world, and the fact that our experience here really has been very badly spoiled. It's not been a comfortable fit. It's like wearing a bad shoe. You've got blisters. You know, how can we enjoy it? It's like going on a walk, beautiful place, we're walking and our shoes are just like blistering, are so uncomfortable, our feet are aching, we're just in so much pain, and we're so upset at the shoes because it ruined our walk. We just didn't enjoy it one bit. That's the situation like it's in the world right now. Has been. So yeah, you don't like those shoes. You're happy to get rid of those shoes, that's for sure. No more shoes. But with the pain and misery those shoes gave us, we began to think about a lot of stuff. And in doing so, we discovered an amazing truth. And now we're dwelling in this incredible bliss. And so we say, hey, thank you, shoes, for being such a lousy pair of shoes. It really ended up, I ended up making lemonade out of this lemon. So the sooner we get to that point, the better it is for us. Otherwise, we're going to be very sour and bitter and resentful. As the world is turning that way, you can tell that people are just saying, my gosh, it's easy to see how the world could get very bitter about things. You know, people are throwing up their hands saying, too much trouble, it's unsolvable. You know, what's going to happen? It's like, grinding their gears. They don't realize what salvation is, but their salvation is here. It's a road that can be taken. And so the gears are grinding worse and worse and worse. And that's not a happy situation for anybody, that is for sure. And more irritation will arise. People will try to keep their jovial selves intact by using drugs and various other things, trying to, you know, they don't want to be this way and mean and snappy and sour and pouty and resentful and bitter. They don't want to be that. And depressed, you know, they don't want to be depressed, so they'll try to keep themselves perking along, but it takes a terrible toll on them, a terrible toll. You might say the world is like a meth addict. You've seen how before and after pictures of meth addicts. Well, you might say the whole planet is a meth addict right now. Planet Earth is a meth addict at this point. And you see what happens. You can see what happens happening to the planet. The changes in meth addicts are just shocking, terrifying, really. What happens? You see a beautiful, smiley person before and then after. Oh my God! It's just too terrible to look at. Well, the world is a meth addict, and so it's just, you know, it's just shriveling up into this corpse. And of course, people don't like that. If there's someone you love and you see them a meth addict and they see what's happening, you know, that's very upsetting. It's very upsetting. But again, realize that this is all just a simulation. It's all a simulation. It's not real. And that we can also simulate stepping into timelessness. We can simulate a preparation to step into timelessness, where everything appears perfect. It all appears. Oneness is untouched. The oneness, the quality of oneness is untouched. And that is what we're looking for. That is the bliss. This experiencing of oneness, untouched by anything that happens. The dance. The floor is untouched by the dance that is being danced on the floor, as it were. The floor remains perfect, no matter what kind of dance is being danced on it. The stage is untouched by the dance. And so, in other words, there's no definition of the stage, quote unquote. There's nothing being defined. The dance is not defining oneness at all, no matter what the dance is. So we abide in this realization of oneness, of undefinedness, and realize that this undefinedness is not being touched at all. And then that's the condition of the great the great ones who simply abide in this realization. That's the Ramana Maharshi, who simply abides in this realization that the oneness is not being touched by this dance at all, by this simulation of time, doesn't touch it at all. So the bliss is just untouched, just overflowing bliss. Radiant happiness, you know, radiant. Sometimes Ramana seemed distant because he was absorbed in this great calm. But when he would relate to others, this radiant bliss was there. And this is the condition of those, is sometimes they are absorbed in this deep calm and they seem so remote and distant almost. And then to relating to others, they come out of this and you get this incredible bliss. They're so happy to see you. You know, you can't believe why. You say, why are they so happy to see me? The real teachers, I'm telling you, they are overjoyed to see you. That's how you can tell someone who's truly enlightened, is they see you and they're so happy to see you, because what they're seeing is that how you define yourself is not affecting the oneness in the slightest bit, and they're so happy about that. And they're so happy to let you see this. They're so happy to let you see this. So they're not seeing you, the personality. They're seeing that the oneness is untouched by your personality. And therefore that means that you are free too. You're not defined by your personality. So they are truly very blissful to see you. You can see that there's radiant joy from them, you know, that bit. And you think, what did I do to deserve this? You know, wow, how come they're so happy to see me? Now you know why. Those are the ones that are truly liberated. They're happy to see everything. Always happy, always blissful. Like you say, wow, why are they so blissful? What is that? Because everything they see, is just more evidence that this definition of a thing is not touching the oneness at all, and they're super happy about that. So let's see, we've redefined. This is the true use of redefinition. We can take definition and give it a useful turn to it by defining, as it were, what enlightenment is like, so that at least we have some expectations and realize, oh, it's not what we thought. We've had it misdefined. So the use of definition is to undo the misdefinition, as it were. We think they're happy to see us. No. They're just happy that what we think we are is not what we are. And they're happy to share that with us. Happy to share. We think, oh, but I want you to see me. And the teacher says, I'm not seeing you as I'm seeing the absence of you. In other words, the absence as you as defined, as you as a definition, they're seeing the absence of that. It's nowhere for them. So this is the real teacher. Those are the ones. they cannot not be blissful. And so some of them don't like that. They say, can you just stop being blissful and experience what I am, how I'm defined, so you can help me work on my definition and show me how I can define myself better. They cannot. No, they cannot. because as you're defined to them is the absence of definition. They're experiencing the absence of how you're defining yourself. It's not there. So if we can approach this, we're approaching this, see clarity on this, that means we can approach a true liberated sage without and feel what's there. The absence of what I thought, the definition, absence of definition of what I am, the absence of that. That the great calm is totally impersonal. The bliss seems to have at least some connection with you, because they seem to be addressing someone there. There seems to be a little more personal feel to it. So even in the talking about this, there is a happiness that arises. That's what I've experienced. Because I'm happy to be seeing this. It makes me happy, absolutely. I wouldn't call it happiness. I'd call it more an expectation of bliss. There's an expectation of bliss. It's not a personal happiness. It's not something I can label as something belonging to a person. I do, but I feel this sense of liberation coming. Liberation from definition. See, a true liberated sage is not for the purposes of idolatry. Just the opposite. People go to idols to strengthen their definition of what they are. But you go to a liberated sage to be liberated from your definition, from all definitions of what is. Liberated from definitions, from labels. So at some point, words become a little bit awkward, you know, impose on the mood. Words can impose upon, intrude upon it, they intrude upon it. That's what I'm experiencing now. I'd rather just, you know, feel the feeling. But because I've taken on this role of sharing this, I still use words, but they do feel like they're impinging on something. Which is why liberated sages are often, they're blissful, they often don't say much. Because they know you're feeling something, they don't want to impinge upon that with words. Very great. This is excellent, excellent work here. Ending on a very non-defined note. All right, that's it.